again. I've been working in agriculture for over 40 years, and for at least half of that, it's been involved in biological agriculture. So I'm an agronomist. I work with plants and soils to get the best, to get the optimization from that. So it's a science-based profession. And what we do is we look at precision farming, really, in a word, but we look at more natural inputs and utilizing nature's power to our advantage to produce high quality food and really good yields.
Okay. You said natural agriculture just now. Did you say that? Yeah. Could you explain to us what that means? Yeah.
Well, I call it natural growing. Now, it doesn't mean that we do nothing, and just let nature take its course. No, we understand the important parts of nature that we can utilize without disturbing and destroying that power, but we harness those resources from nature in the process of growing high quality food. So that obviously farming is a disturbance against what you'd normally call natural environment, but we do the least possible harm or least possible disturbance that we can do. And in fact, we actually harness those resources of nature wherever possible. Things like beneficial microbes. We look at the balance of soil minerals, and we look at restoring and improving organic carbon. And those three factors, microbes, minerals, and matter, is really at the heart of our agronomy programs.
Okay, so it's microbes, minerals, matter. Okay, yeah. So that's a little bit, a very quick and short snippet of natural agriculture. How many years have you been working in this area, in this field?
The first 25 years of my career, I was involved in chemical agriculture, synthetic fertilizers and pesticides. And then just before 2000, I had an epiphany and actually moved across into sustainable agriculture. That's what it was called back then. But it's really now what we understand as regenerative agriculture. So we are leaving the soil and the farm in a better position than it was when we started.
Wow.
And that's the key. And that's the whole, I think that's one of the powers of permaculture and one of the principles that you've adopted on Food Forest Farm, where we're doing the most we can with nature's power and creating the least disturbance, and certainly improving the balance if we can.
Can you share a little bit about Food Forest Farm, which is actually the Kind Growers Farm? That's how we are introducing the Kind Grower and the Food Forest Farm to the global world. So we're introducing Malaysia Noses now into Singapore and hopefully soon in Hong Kong. What I think we would like to know more is how do you see our farming methods now? How do you see Food Forest Farm now? And you know, the journey and also how will you characterize us? Like, are we practicing regenerative agriculture? How would you, now as it is now, Food Forest Farm, since we started, say, in 2009 with permaculture and then with our agri-tech systems, you know?
Okay. Well, from the moment I set foot on the Food Forest Farm, I realised, and I believe that it's been the same it's been the same philosophy ever since the farm was started, is that there was an intention never to use pesticides, an intention to farm within the boundaries of that property in the most positive way, to avoid disturbing the natural environment. Even though some areas had to be shaped and cultivated and turned into productive areas, my impressions in the beginning was that there was a real drive to prove that food could be grown this way, integrated into a natural environment, so that people could work and live there safely.
Safe good food, was that something that you came up with, or did you come up with that? I think you had shared that with me quite early on. You were really excited, you know, safe good food. So Steve had mentioned you know, a drive to prove that food can be integrated and people can work and live there safely. So can we just have a little bit of your vision, you know, at that time, so when you started the farm?
Yeah, when we started the farm, we started learning permaculture. It was basically us trying to find a solution after seeing what's happening in the area that we are in, looking at all the agriculture that's happening, learning from the growers around us, observing what they are growing and how they are selling what they are growing. So we were looking for a solution, a way to do something sustainably. So permaculture was the first approach of understanding how things could be done safely. So of course, the motivation for us to go into agriculture is to produce or to grow food. Not at that time when we started, we were not looking at scale. We were actually looking at how do we grow food actually, and what crops would grow well in the land that we have and the climate that we are in, right? So that's how we started. So basically, so from food, after knowing what would grow well, then the intention was to grow good food. And so I thought, you know, what makes good food? Good food is, actually nutrition, right? Is for us. And food, basically the most important thing with food being good, that it has to be safe for us to consume. So that's how we came up with the whole concept of safe, good food.
Yeah, I'd like to add that along the lines that safe, good food, from my perspective, means that it is safe to grow for a start. And one thing I've noticed, particularly in my travels in India and in Asia, is that pesticides are used heavily. And a lot of farm workers are at risk every day they go to work, just, you know, with their intention of growing food. They put their lives at risk having to spray these chemicals, and many of them are banned everywhere else around the world. So just by eliminating pesticides for a start, you make a workplace that is a joy to work in. You don't have to worry about your own health or the health of your children, who may also be coming on as workers later on. So safe to grow and as well safe to eat. So, you know, we have to look after our consumers. We don't want to have to jeopardize anyone's health in the process of growing food.
Yeah, so you had both mentioned the word intention. I really liked it, you know, that it's got to be intentional first, right? And I love how Pinkett hits it home to being food that's safe to eat. And now you're adding on another layer for us, Steve, that the commitment is actually about a safe workplace, right? So
it is. And I'm sorry, that because labor, agricultural labor is becoming a finite resource. It's becoming scarce to find and keep skilled labor. And if you are a farm that doesn't use pesticides and doesn't have that health issue for workers, they will choose you.
Yeah, I'm smiling a lot more. Our new logo is a smiley, but after this, I'm really holding my hand to the heart. I'm just glowing, you know. It's
anybody who can produce high quality, high yields without pesticides will become an employer of choice.
Yeah, wow. Ooh, I like that.
Well as a producer.
Yeah, you know, that's right. And and supplier of choice, producer of choice, yeah. So tell us, what has the farm accomplished, right? We know we saw the results of the pesticide residue lab test, you know, we sent it for several times during the year, selecting from different crops. Can you share with us very quickly the two types of tests that we've undertaken and what were kind of your findings?
Okay, well, first, when we first got started, we there was a pesticide screen that was run by a particular laboratory, and they looked at 45 different pesticide groups, including some herbicides, mostly insecticides, and a few fungicides. So the general grouping of pesticides that were used on Malaysian farms. But what I noticed there was a lot of those materials were out of patent and actually outdated chemicals. Now, that doesn't mean they're not being used. It's just that even though there were no detections, which is a really good result, you know, everything was under the actual limit of detection for the sophisticated machinery that was used to test those samples. There were no detections, but I was more interested in proprietary chemistry, which is out there now. And that first test of 45 pesticides didn't cover anywhere near what was potentially available. In terms of proving the point. So the second lot of tests came about 4 or 5 months later. It was run by a very well-respected laboratory, an international group, ALS. We have ALS here in Australia. They're governed by Standards Malaysia, and their screening included 232 active ingredients. Many of those are what I consider to be novel and current pesticide technology. So we covered a much, much bigger screen for a start, but we also included things that we were missing in the last test, the first test that was conducted. And again, there were nil detections, there was nothing found in that very comprehensive test.
Wow. Yeah, we were so excited when you were sharing this, and then you had said to us, then we are pesticide free. and we, after the first test, was basically having the credence claim that we're insecticide free. So lots of people then started to ask us, so what is the difference between insecticide free and pesticide free?
Well, let's look at it from the point of view of it doesn't matter how you farm. If you can farm without the use of insecticides, or more importantly, without the use of pesticides, which includes insecticides, herbicides, fungicides, and growth regulators. There's quite a few growth regulators that shouldn't be used. If you can do that by skillfully managing nutrition and by understanding pest dynamics, pest and disease dynamics, using integrated pest management techniques, then you're way ahead, because in most cases your yields and quality are very high because you've already addressed the full nutritional program that the crop requires. To be strong enough to avoid being attacked by pests and diseases. In other words, you don't need those chemicals in the first place if you address proper nutrition. I just get the feeling that we need more phosphorus in this mix, and also some mycorrhizae or something like that to get the roots branching. At this stage, when you supply a plant with a lot of moisture, it doesn't have to work hard to grow root. Then MicroShield at 10 to 12.
Yes.
Then MicroShield. Oh. So we're going MicroShield, MicroShield, MicroShield. So in other words, Trichoderma a number of times while the plants were young, in week one, to try to control any disease problem on the small root. After that, there shouldn't be any more problem with loss of small plants.